Hello friends, welcome to Unacademy. Unacademy, my friends, is India's largest learning platform. If you get a Plus subscription, it gives you access to unlimited live and recorded courses from India's best educators. You'll get daily live classes where you can interact with your faculty, ask your doubts and queries, get them solved there and then. So it's like a live classroom experience. The courses are structured, keeping in line the latest NEET PG syllabus. There are live tests and quizzes which will help you evaluate your performance. And one subscription gives you unlimited access to all of the live and recorded sessions from all of the faculties. There are top educators who are associated with the platform, like Dr. Nikita Nanvani, Dr. Mohammed Azam, Dr. Preeti Mishra, Dr. Divesh Mishra Sir. Various courses are offered, all 19 subjects are covered, and every now and then comprehensive batch courses and concise crash courses, they keep getting launched. So check out the ongoing courses in the platform as well. As far as the subscription packages go, there are short duration packages like 3 months and 6 months, and longer duration packages like 12 months and 24 months. So for those of you who are targeting the next year exams, like the mid-year AIIMS, PGI, JIPMER, and NIMHANS, they can take the 12-month subscription. It will give you ample time to go through all the sessions as well as revise in the end. And it turns out to be far more economical in the long run, just ₹2,083 per month. And for those of you who are in the third year and final year and want a slower pace of preparation, you can go ahead and take the 24-month subscription. It will turn out to be far more economical in the longer run, just ₹1,250 per month. And if you subscribe using my code, that is SHONALI, then you can avail a 10% discount on your subscription, whatever subscription package that you choose. Well, the problem begins in the placenta itself. So look at this diagram here. It's a diagram showing you the placenta. So you can see here that we have the umbilical cord, which is the connecting link between the mother and the fetus here. It connects the fetus with the placenta, right? We can see here that there is the chorionic plate in the placenta, right? That is the fetal component. Then there is the decidual plate, which is the maternal component of the placenta. And we can also see in this figure here that these are the chorionic villi. These are the chorionic villi which make up the chorionic plate, right? And it is in these chorionic villi that the fetal blood vessels are traveling, right? And then we can also see here that these are the intervillous spaces in between these anchoring chorionic villi in which the maternal blood moves and maternal blood flows. And maternal blood is entering these intervillous spaces by way of these spiral arterioles. Now it is these spiral arterioles which are supplying the decidua basalis, all right, that is the decidual plate here, and it is these spiral arterioles which are perfusing the placenta by maternal blood. And then exchange of nutrients, oxygen, and everything, wastes, excretory wastes, everything takes place between the maternal blood and the fetal blood across this placental barrier. So this is what the gross structure or a diagrammatic representation of the placenta looks like. But to understand the pathophysiology, let us go a little bit deeper and try to figure out what happens, right? So if I were to zoom this diagram here, if I were to zoom this diagram here and go dig deeper and find out what is happening here in the placenta, I'll see something like this. So these are the intervillous spaces, these are the anchoric chorionic villi, these are the decidua basalis here, alright, this is the basal plate or the maternal plate or the maternal component of the placenta. We have the superficial myometrium here, right, the spiral arterioles can be seen that are entering the decidua basalis and then perfusing the intervillous spaces with maternal blood. There are these anchoring chorionic villi which we are seeing here, right? Now these chorionic villi are lined by two types of cells. So these outer bright green, this outer bright green layer of cells, I've shown it as a single line, but actually it's a multinucleated layer of invasive cells which is called as the syncytiotrophoblast. This is called as the syncytiotrophoblast, right? So chorionic villi on the outside are lined by the syncytiotrophoblast, and on the inside here, there is a single layer of cells which is called as the cytotrophoblast. right? So there is a single layer cell on the inside that is called as the cytotrophoblast. Now these cytotrophoblasts, which are there present in the chorionic villi, in the anchoring villi, they are called as the villous cytotrophoblast, right? So we have the villous cytotrophoblast. Now some of these cytotrophoblasts, they leave the chorionic villi and they enter and invade into the decidua basalis. So these are the extravillous cytotrophoblasts, all right? Now some of these extravillous cytotrophoblasts are going to stay there in the decidua basalis, but some of them are going to move into and invade the spiral arterioles. Now these become what we call as the endovascular cytotrophoblasts. So cytotrophoblasts are very invasive in nature. They invade the decidua basalis. They also invade the spiral arterioles, and those are the endovascular cytotrophoblasts. When they invade the spiral arterioles, after that, what happens is vascular remodeling. So vascular remodeling takes place in the spiral arterioles, right? The endothelial lining of the spiral arterioles is replaced by the endovascular cytotrophoblast. The muscle layer of the spiral arterioles undergoes fibrinoid necrosis, converting these spiral arterioles here into loose vascular channels. Now that is very, very important. This is a very important step in placental formation. Why? Because the intravillous spaces need to be perfused by the maternal blood all the time. Right? Now the blood flow, the maternal blood flow to the uterine arteries, to the uterus and to the placenta increase many, many times, many, many times folds, right? And all that increased blood needs to reach these intravillous spaces to keep the placenta well perfused with maternal blood. That is a very, very important requirement of placental formation. And to achieve that, the spiral arterioles have to become loose vascular channels, so that they allow blood flow into these intravillous spaces uninterrupted. This process is called as vascular remodeling. And this vascular remodeling takes place in two phases. So in the first phase, this vascular remodeling proceeds in the layer of the decidua basalis, right? So the first phase happens till 12 weeks of pregnancy, till 12 weeks of gestation. Then in the second phase of this vascular remodeling, the remodeling is going to go a little deeper into the superficial myometrium, that is the second phase, and it lasts till 16 weeks. So all this placental formation, anatomical modification is taking place till 16 weeks of gestation. Very, very crucial time during placental formation. And it is this crucial vascular remodeling which does not happen properly in preeclampsia. Very, very important point to note is what happens in preeclampsia. This vascular remodeling is defective because there is incomplete trophoblast invasion of the spiral arterioles. The spiral artery remodeling is defective. The spiral arterioles, instead of becoming loose vascular channels, they remain narrow. So it will look something like this. This is something that is normal. This is normal remodeling. And look what happens in preeclampsia. Look what happens. The spiral arteriolar remodeling is defective. It is not complete. The spiral arterioles, they continue to remain narrow. So less blood. So blood flow through these spiral arterioles into the intervillous spaces. That is also less, right? So that leads to placental ischemia. Less blood enters the intravascular spaces, and that leads to release of inflammatory mediators in this placental circulation, like the cytokines, the tumor necrosis factors, the interleukin. So there are hordes of inflammatory mediators that are released, and these inflammatory mediators are not just confined to the through the placental circulation, but they will seep into the maternal circulation as well, into the rest of the maternal circulation. circulation as well, leading to endothelial damage wherever these inflammatory mediators go. So the centerpiece of the pathology, when you talk about what is the centerpiece of the pathology here in preeclampsia, my friends, it is endothelial damage. And it is this endothelial damage which is happening not just in the placental circulation, but in various organ systems, in various vascular systems of the body as well. And that is the centerpiece of pathology in preeclampsia. So preeclampsia is not just a disorder where there's only hypertension, mind you. There is a lot of complications that can happen depending upon how much endothelial damage is occurring, which organs are involved in this process, and that will determine how severe this preeclampsia becomes or how complicated this preeclampsia becomes. So let us see that, how that is all brought about. So all of this endothelial damage, you see, it leads to various sequelae or complications like vasospasm and ischemic sequelae. It causes leaky capillaries. Wherever there's endothelial damage, it leads to thrombotic sequelae, right? So because of this vasospasm and ischemic sequelae, obviously the blood flow to the respective organs is compromised, right? It will also lead to these leaky capillaries is going to cause the fluid to move out from the intervascular space into the interstitial spaces, leading to this edema and leading to what we call as hemoconcentration. So this is leaky capillaries causing fluid to move out from the intravascular spaces to the interstitial spaces, and here inside it leads to hemoconcentration. So this would be what the blood vessel looks like in a woman with preeclampsia. It is hemoconcentrated. All these RBCs that are increasing in number in pregnancy, they're clubbed together here. A lot of hemoconcentration is there. Now this is something very, very dangerous, mind you, because if you remember, we talked about the physiological changes in pregnancy, and there we discussed that in pregnancy what happens is hemodilution. So in a woman who is undergoing the normal changes in pregnancy, there is hemodilution. On the contrary, in preeclampsia, there is hemoconcentration. Now try to understand that if this woman is going to lose blood, let's say if this woman loses 500 ml of blood, then more of plasma is lost and less of RBCs are lost in that finite 500 ml volume, for example, right? So this hemodilution is protective because less of RBCs are lost. But consider a woman with preeclampsia loses the same amount of blood. If the woman with preeclampsia loses the same amount of blood during delivery, during postpartum hemorrhage, then this is something that cannot be tolerated very well by the woman. So preeclampsia is dangerous because the woman cannot even tolerate small amounts of blood loss, because she will lose a lot of RBCs in the process, even if she loses the same amount of blood as a pregnant woman who is healthy. So that is why this hemoconcentration is particularly dangerous in a woman with preeclampsia. You can see here, wherever there is endothelial damage, you see, the platelets are going to come there, the platelets are activated, and these platelets are going to cause thrombosis here in these vessels. So these lead to a lot of thrombotic sequelae that happen in preeclampsia. So a set of consequences happen: vasospastic, because of leaky capillaries, because of thrombotic sequelae, all which are originating because of endothelial damage. So let's have a look. Because of this vasospasm and ischemic sequelae, there can be, as a direct result of that, there can be hypertension, hepatic necrosis. Vasospasm and ischemia in the liver circulation will lead to hepatic necrosis. If that happens in the retinal circulation, in the retina, in the eye, then it can lead to retinal ischemia, can lead to loss of vision because of that. Sometimes this retinal one's ischemia might be so severe as to cause retinal detachment, you know. So this can also happen, but it is again a severe manifestation, right? Because of this hepatic necrosis, there is increase in liver enzymes in preeclampsia. So the SGOT and the SGPT, these liver enzymes are raised to more than 2 times above the normal limit, increased to more than 2 times above the normal limit. So this can happen in preeclampsia. The liver dysfunction also takes place in severe preeclampsia. You can see here in the inset, see in this figure, that because of this ischemic sequelae, sometimes in severe cases, there can be periportal hemorrhages as well. The endovascular damage, the friable capillaries, they can rupture, they can lead to these periportal hemorrhages, and these periportal hemorrhages are going to cause the stretching of the capsule of the liver, and that will cause right hypochondriac or epigastric pain. Another manifestation of severe preeclampsia, right hypochondriac or epigastric pain. Sometimes these hemorrhages can be so severe as to cause hepatic rupture. Now, hepatic rupture does not happen very often, but if it happens, it is a life-threatening, dangerous consequence of severe preeclampsia. So you see how preeclampsia can affect the liver, cause dysfunction, can even cause hepatic rupture under very, very severe circumstances. All of these leaky capillaries in the circulation, systemic circulation, in the peripheral circulation, in the renal circulation, all of these leaky capillaries, they will lead to edema. So you can see here, you can see a pitting edema on the legs in a woman with preeclampsia. Now, normally, some physiological edema does happen in pregnancy, but it's not so severe. It's usually limited up to the ankles. But we can see here that the edema is moving up. It is moving up. It can be right up to the knees, maybe even above that. So that degree of severe edema can be there because of these leaky capillaries. You can see here, this is the diagram showing the urine sample. So this is for you to remember that these leaky capillaries in the glomerular circulation can also lead to leakage of protein in the urine. So proteinuria is another complication that can happen. These leaky capillaries can lead to leaking out of the intravascular fluid into the interstitial compartment in the lungs, and sometimes in severe manifestation it can even cause pulmonary edema. When these leaky capillaries and endothelial damage is extending to the cerebral circulation, it can even lead to cerebral edema. So all of these pathological processes happen because of the endothelial damage, which contributes to leaky capillaries in the maternal system. And depending upon which organs are involved, depending upon how severe the preeclampsia is, it can be manifested with pulmonary edema also. That is one complication of severe preeclampsia. Cerebral edema, another complication of severe preeclampsia. So these can also happen in severe cases of preeclampsia. And particularly important to note is how are the kidneys involved in preeclampsia. So you see here on the inset in the figure, on the left side we see a normal glomerulus, right, a normal circulation of the kidney. So you can see here that this is the basement membrane. You can see here this is the endothelium of the glomerular capillaries, okay. And we can see that it is nicely fenestrated and everything. But all that endothelial damage that happens in the glomerular circulation, it can lead to endothelial swelling. It can lead to the swollen fenestra. So you can figure out that the glomerular filtration rate, right, that can fall in preeclampsia, it can lead to oliguria, decreased urine production. It can lead to oliguria. It can also lead to glomerular endotheliosis. Finally, all this endothelial damage and swelling in the endothelium is leading to a pathological process which is called as glomerular endotheliosis. Now, this glomerulus, This glomerulus is unable to filter creatinine out of the maternal system. So creatinine is not being able to be filtered out into the urine. So that leads to increased serum creatinine, another severe manifestation of preeclampsia, increased serum creatinine. For the same reason, there will be increased serum uric acid in the maternal system. So these are the complications that can happen because of the kidneys involvement in preeclampsia. And again, the pathological process that is contributing to this all is endothelial damage, endothelial swelling, and a consequence of that, glomerular endotheliosis, which is contributing to all of these changes that are happening in the woman's body in preeclampsia. Now, what can the thrombotic sequelae be? Well, the thrombotic sequelae is going to be, see, all the platelets are getting activated. They are causing thrombosis in the circulation, in the maternal circulation. So that leads to consumption of the platelets. The platelets are used up. They are consumed. And that leads to another severe manifestation, which is decreased platelet count. Now, this thrombotic sequelae is not only limited to the placental circulation. It can happen all over the body as well, depending again on the severity of endothelial damage or the underlying pathophysiological process. Now, when these thrombosis are involving the placental circulation, what does that lead to? So have a look at here. This is the placenta. It is connected to the fetus by way of this umbilical cord. This is the umbilical cord which is connecting the baby to the placenta, right? So a lot of thrombosis here in this placental circulation can lead to the placental ischemia. The narrow spiral arterioles are already there. Less maternal blood is reaching the intervascular spaces. Less is available for the fetus to extract oxygen and nutrients from. On the other hand, thrombosis also is happening in the placental circulation. So the fetus is not able to extract out enough oxygen, enough nutrients from the mother's blood, and that can lead to intrauterine growth retardation of the fetus, another consequence of preeclampsia. On top of that, the spiral arterioles that are perfusing this placenta, the spiral arterioles are ischemic, they are narrow, right? They are friable, and blood flow through these spiral arterioles wants to increase in pregnancy. Blood flow through the placenta needs to increase in this pregnancy, but the arterioles are narrow, mind you. So they can rupture sometimes in the face of extensively increased BP. If there is high BP, sometimes this spiral arterioles can rupture and increase the risk of the placental abruption. So the placental abruption can take place, premature separation of the placenta takes place. If these spiral arterioles rupture, there can be bleeding in this space. There can be bleeding in this space behind here in the decidua basalis, and all this bleeding can lead to premature separation of the placenta. That's called as placental abruption, another risky effect of or risky consequence of preeclampsia in pregnancy. And in severe cases, sometimes, especially if complicated with blood loss and hemorrhage, all of this thrombosis can lead to disseminated intravascular coagulation as well, but it will happen in extremely severe cases, mind you, right? So the thrombotic sequelae can also have a lot of consequences during pregnancy complicated with preeclampsia. And finally now, what is eclampsia then? So we talked about the pathophysiology of preeclampsia. What is eclampsia? Well, when preeclampsia gets complicated with convulsions, that state is called as eclampsia. Now, my question to you is, and a question to ponder over is, can a woman develop can a woman present with eclampsia without going through all the complications of severe preeclampsia? Can it happen? Yes or no? Yes, it can happen. Yes, a woman can have convulsions present with eclampsia even without going through the various complications of severe preeclampsia that is possible. In fact, about 10 to 15% women with eclampsia might even have normal BP, might even have normal blood pressure. That's because of the pathology of eclampsia. That is because of the pathology. So let us understand what happens in eclampsia, what is the pathophysiology of eclampsia. So the pathophysiology is explained by two things. One, there is theory of vasogenic edema. Secondly, there is a loss of cerebral autoregulation. Now, normally, you have to understand what happens outside of pregnancy. Whenever there is sudden high BP, our brain needs to get itself protected, right? So the brain vessels, the blood vessels of the brain have this capacity of constricting in response to sudden high BP. So they lead to decreased blood flow into the brain. That happens, that is called as cerebral autoregulation. That is a normal protective mechanism against high BP outside of pregnancy. Now this cerebral autoregulation is not functioning properly in a woman with preeclampsia. There's loss of cerebral autoregulation. So with high BP, a lot of blood is entering into the cerebral circulation, right? So we see what happens because of this loss of cerebral autoregulation is that it leads to cerebral hyperperfusion. And this cerebral hyperperfusion has a tendency to involve the occipital lobe and the parietal lobe of the brain. A tendency, natural tendency to affect the parietal and occipital lobes of the brain. So it leads to a throbbing occipital headache. It leads to blurring of vision as well, right? So this is because of cerebral hyperperfusion which takes place. These are again severe signs, and when these are present, it is suggestive of impending eclampsia. If a woman with preeclampsia complains of throbbing headache, blurring of vision, then it means that she can have a convulsion any moment, any time now. That is what impending eclampsia means. So on the one hand, there is cerebral hyperperfusion, a lot of blood perfusing the cerebral circulation, and on top of that, there is underlying endothelial damage. So a lot of blood perfusing the cerebral circulation, endothelial damage, blood perfusing, endothelial damage, leaking of the fluid from the intravascular to the interstitial spaces leads to cerebral edema. Cerebral edema occurs, cerebral edema will happen, and all this cerebral edema, all of this endothelial damage is going to cause the release of excitatory neurotransmitters in the brain, particularly glutamate. So these excitatory neurotransmitters are released, and that causes convulsions in a woman with preeclampsia. So you see here that the pathogenesis determines that the cerebral hyperperfusion, this endothelial damage, can even happen at lower BP levels. The BP need not be 200 by 120 for eclampsia to take place. And eclampsia can even happen in a woman whose BP is 140 by 90 for that matter, 150 by 100 for that matter, because the pathology says that there is cerebral hyperperfusion because of loss of cerebral autoregulation, underlying endothelial damage, and cerebral edema contribute to convulsions, right? So there can be a woman with eclampsia, maybe who's not gone through the other severe manifestations of preeclampsia, right? So you get that now? So eclampsia is, mind you, very, very dangerous. It's very, very dangerous for the woman's life. Why? Because you have to realize that the woman's mental status or cognitive status after eclampsia can vary. After this episode of convulsion, she could recover her consciousness. Sometimes she can go into a comatose state also. Sometimes she might be left lethargic and drowsy. And such varied manifestations of eclampsia takes place. Why? Because the cerebral edema can involve a part of the brain. It can be limited to the occipital and parietal region, or it can involve the whole cerebrum, involve the whole brain, right? So the degree of cerebral edema, the degree of involvement of the brain will determine whether the woman recovers from these convulsions or whether the woman remains in a comatose, in a drowsy, and a lethargic state, right? So if you talk about the central nervous system manifestations, there can be convulsions, there can be coma, there can be lethargy, drowsiness, all depending upon how severe this cerebral edema is. So all the pathophysiology of preeclampsia and eclampsia revolves around endothelial damage. This endothelial damage is originating from where? From the inflammatory mediators that have been released in the placenta. That is where the problem is. The root of the cause is there in the chorionic villi, in the spiral arterioles where the remodeling is defective. It all began there. So mind you, the only effective modality for treatment of preeclampsia and eclampsia, the definitive treatment, mind you, is removal of that placenta, delivery of the woman, delivery of the baby. Once the baby is out, once the placenta is out, once the source of that inflammatory mediators is gone, only then the woman will truly recover. So that's about the pathophysiology of preeclampsia and eclampsia. In the next session, we're going to talk about the clinical management of this very condition. Thank you. So you can subscribe to the Unacademy platform by using my code, that is SHONALI. That will help you to avail a 10% discount on the subscription. You can hit the bell icon for notifications. So thank you guys for watching. I hope it has been helpful.